This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to GoOnlineTrainings.com. Manam, we are talking about complex stored procedures, right? So one of the example that we have taken from our case study itself, right? So we have two case studies. Three case studies I have provided. One is Indian Bank case study. So in this, when you go to the end you will be able to find out your stored procedure, right? So that has been implemented yesterday, and make sure you complete this, you know, case study. You invest lot of time, so see training where you can do lot of mistakes, and once you are placed, right, so you cannot do any mistakes over there, right? Definitely training is the place you people have to do a lot of mistakes, right? So that means you need to do a lot of thinking and practice in this time only, okay? So if you say that if you don't have time or you did not implement these case studies, then definitely you will be the loser, I'm telling you, right? So invest the time. Let it take 1 more month extra, but still you need to invest your time in our case studies, clear? If you know SQL Server very well, getting a job in MSBA, Power BI, very, very easy. 60 to 70% work will be available only in SQL. Remaining 40% may be there in MSBA and Power BI, right? So you can easily crack the interview. You can easily work on, right? So don't waste your time. You have to invest your time in our case studies without fail. If you're not able to understand, just call me, or you know, come to my office and you know, ask me if you're in, you know, in my city, right? Otherwise, you know, you can just ping me and ask me, but invest your time. So we had completed yesterday these things, right? So these are the things we had implemented. Then if you wanted to have total number of transactions, total cash deposits and cash withdrawals, this is also to be printed, and dates when the balance dropped below the minimum balance for the product. What is the meaning of this? For example, your bank may say that you know, you're supposed to maintain let us say $1,000 in your account, or so this is account master table, and we're talking about account ID, name, and see balance, right? You understand the domain now, because without understanding domain you will not be able to write your code. Many people thinks that if I know technology I can do anything. Knowing technology is something different than the knowing this one. So Bhaskar is open an account with zero, and Simrit is open an account with zero, so account master table, and we have a transaction master table, right? So we have date of transaction, account ID, right, and a transaction type, and what is the amount you are going to, you know, deposit or withdraw. So some Jan 12th 2020, Bhaskar is opened an account, and account number one, and a type cash deposit of, let us say, 1,000. So the day one I have deposited 1,000, my balance will be 1,000. Automatically we need to update here, okay? As of now the updations are not happening in our table. Now the next day, so probably 13th, I again go to the bank, and again I deposit another, let us say, 23,000, right? It will become 1,000 plus 23, it will become 24,000. That is my current balance. Clear? Now, Simrit also go, you know, Simrit also, you know, opened the account on the next day, 13th, and she has deposited, let us, you know, $2,000 she has deposited. Now, according to the bank, every customer has to maintain minimum 1,000 balance in their account numbers. Clear? So that is what is the minimum balance. How much they're supposed to maintain? 1,000 minimum has to be there. So I have 24,000, and she has, 2000. Clear? Now she went to the, this one after, let us say, 24th of Jan, and withdrawal has happened up to 1500. Okay, now her balance is only 500. Now I wanted to know date when her balance has dropped the minimum balance. When is that? 24th. That I have to print here. Clear? So 24th Jan 2020, she has dropped her balance, because we're supposed to maintain 1000. So now it is 500. Okay, it is not meeting the criteria. Again, 25th or next month, next month, let us say 4th, she went to the bank, and it is a cash withdrawal, right? So cash deposit of 5000 has been done, right? Now it will become 5500. There's no problem. So again, after some time, customer number one goes and cash withdrawal, okay, cash withdrawal goes, and 5000, right? Or you will say 24,000, complete amount is taken, it will become a zero. Okay, so this date has to come in his report. Clear? So his report, you need to say 4th February completely amount has been taken, no amount in the bank. So it's supposed to maintain 1000, but it is not there. Clear? So that is what it has to be there. So this is what we need to implement. Clear? So this data you can implement, and total number of transactions also to be implemented. So let me go to use IBank and SP underscore help. If you wanted to get your stored proc name, right? So SP underscore help text stored proc name. So go to IBank. Now go to programmability. See, I did not save it anywhere, because stored proc is available here, previous month bank statement. Okay, so remove this DBO and everything. Now execute it. So this is the stored proc. Copy it, and you should be able to place them. So this is a stored proc I had written yesterday, right? So you can just see it. So see, now stored proc is completely neatly available. Everything is available. Create a proc name, and this was the stored proc. Customer info, print the variables, right? A lot of things been implemented. At the end, this one, after this print, I wanted to implement these things. Okay, so what are the things I need to implement? So number of transactions and all these things need to be implemented. Copy and paste it there. Okay, so let me print here. Total number of transactions so is available. Total number of transactions is available where, for example, if I take the data of 101, okay, and last month data, all the data I'm dumping into this table, right? So this table will have a total number of transactions. I can read this table. So total number of transactions are equivalent to number of rows in this table, right? Number of rows in this table itself. Okay, so you can use this, or you can count once more, or you can already, the number of rows in this table is equivalent to number of transactions, right? So that is already available here itself. So this is
the count itself is number of transaction. Simply, you can take this count and you should be able to have that, okay? So number of transactions cast as varchar. Okay, number of transactions, total number of transactions, because number of transactions are number of rows coming, you know, using this query. This data I'm dumping into this table, it is available here, and for the looping purpose I'm counting, so it is available in this. The same thing I'm going to be printing it here. That's it, number of transactions. Then the next one is called print, and the next one is called cash, number of, you know, cash deposits. So again you go, and if you wanted to get number of cash deposits, all the data is available in this table, right? In this table you have all the data available, right? So number of cash deposits, you can take this table and you can write number of cash deposits that are available. So you can create, declare one okay, cash deposits integer, and select count star from this table. Okay, where TXN type is equal to cash deposit, right? So this will give you total number of cash deposits, okay, 5, and that I'm going to be linking here. Clear? So now I can have this cast as a varchar. So this has been implemented. Now this will give me number of cash deposits. Now same thing, Control C and the Control V. I can get number of cash withdrawals. Okay, if you have something here, you will be able to get a number of cash withdrawals. That will come here, okay? And number of check deposits. CQD check deposit, and okay, now this is the variable that will be here. That's it. Okay, now total work has been done as of now. Now print total number of transactions. So you can also do the counting. If you don't want to use this, then you can also use the same thing, and total number of transactions can be implemented like this. Okay, number of TXNs. So this will be available here, and you simply count the number of rows in this table once more. That is need not be done, but if you wanted to implement, you can implement total number of rows that you can implement. You can have number of transactions at this. Okay, you can declare one variable and count number of rows from this table, and declare one more variable and count number of cash deposits from this table. Okay, so and declare one more variable and find out number of cash withdrawals, and this one. That's it. Okay. So I'm also printing this. Now I wanted to alter, right? So when you once you create, you supposed to alter this and alter and execute. Done. Now you supposed to call this. Let me open and calling a stored procedure, right? Exec stored proc name. So it is taking this value, right? And let me take, and you can give any other thing, or let me give 101. If you don't give, it will take 101. So you can see this is how you can easily understand. Okay. Now total number of transactions 5. Okay, and all of them are cash deposits only. Total number of cash withdrawals are 0 and 0. So this you need to align it properly, right? If you align it, it will be done. Then at the end, you can also print one more. This one you should be able to print. So all these things clear. So a lot of things can be implemented with the help of this. You can print like this, then you can also print one more, you know, this one, and in between you can write print thanks for banking with us, okay, for more help, okay, for more help call our support or customer care. Okay, so all these things need to be given, and you may have some toll-free number for this bank, you can provide it there. Clear? So all these things we can write it here, and you can simply execute and see. Now end of the day, you are going to be seeing all these things. Thanks for banking with us. For more help, call our customer care number, blah blah blah. So this is how the bankers, you know, the transactions, everything you should be able to get like this. Am I clear? So now, since I am putting hard coding the data for the last month, it can print February, but in the next month this data will change, right? So if you're in June, it has to print what? February. June means May. So you supposed to have that, okay? So how can we print dynamically this kind of things? So that is the purpose. So you need to find out what is the current month. Clear? So this name I wanted to print dynamically, so I will be able to print till this. Okay. And this month I need to print dynamically, because I every month will start with first. So this I need not change it, but this month I need to change it. So I need to get the previous month. How to get the previous month? What I do, I declare. Okay, I declare at the rate month. Okay, month is where, let us say some 40. So how to get, I will take declare at the rate today's date is date and time, right? So is equivalent to, you can give get a date. So if you want to assign to the variable, you can also do this, declare today's date, or you can also say set today's date is equivalent to this, right? So it is going to be taking the today's date into this. Using today's date, I wanted to go back 1 month extra. For example, today is March, right? So I wanted to go back last month. So how to get to last month? I'll say set, okay, set date add mm I wanted to say minus one to this. So what will happen? You will be able to get something, right? So you will go to last month. So you will go to last month, and I don't need anything here. I wanted to get date part mm comma last month. Okay, so if you wanted to print, we can use select as well. Select, let me take this, I'll print something for you. Okay, let me execute all these things. Now see, what are you going to get? You're going to get this one. Okay, date part February. But if I use a date name, if I use a date name, so February, right? Since I am in March, so what I'm doing, I am declaring one variable, forget about it. So you take today's date. So with the help of this, so today's date will be available. So what I'm doing, for the today's date, you take it and you add, you subtract 1 month. 1 month means you will go back. So February. So it will be, you will get the February month if you remove this. If you remove this, and if you remove this, now when you execute it, it will give you, see, February 2021, February month. Okay, and the third. And I don't need February month, I need the month. Okay, so month will be February. So the month I wanted to store in this variable. Okay, now when you see print month, so when you print month, when you print month, it is February. Have you seen this? It is February. So I don't want to print it here. Let me comment this. Now you should know how to get the last month name. So that I wanted to take, and I can just put it here, February month. Okay, last month name, it is going to be printing. Clear? And plus, you can have this in the first, because every month start with the first. You need not do anything here. Then two, okay, two, this we need to change it, last month, right? Last month and the year date, everything has to come here. So how to get the end of the month, that is also very, very important, right? So I wanted to get last month end of the day. So to do that, so I will declare one more variable. So this will give me the month name. Okay, identify the month name here. So this will give me, get the last month name. So what you're doing, you better write it in the, you know, comment, so that other people can understand. Get the last month name. Okay, so last month name you have taken. So this is not the month, I can say beautiful last month. So the variable names also, when you give like this, it will be always good, last month. Okay, so it will be last month. This is also last month you're printing. So after the last month, then you will print blah blah blah, and end date you need to print it, right? So how to get end date of last month? So for that also, I will declare one more. So last month end date, okay, end of the date, something like this. This is also date time, something like this. You wanted to have it, and there is a function called select end of, you know, month. Have you this we discussed, end of the month. So I wanted to take this. Okay, this will go to last month. Okay, this will go to last month. I'll supply the date. So today's date minus one, it will go to last month. Last month end of the day, it is going to be printing it here. Okay, now let me execute this. Now last month. Where is that? Okay, let me execute everything. I think I am supposed to put it. So when I see, I will be able to get last month. Have you seen this? Last month is this. This I wanted to convert and print it. So this, I wanted to take this and I wanted to put it here. So this will bring me last date of previous month. Okay. So this I wanted to print here. Okay, but definitely I wanted to convert this into varchar, and I can have say 107 Indian style date, and plus I say this is a report. Okay, that I wanted to print. Okay, so this I need to end it here. So first to this date of the last month. Have you seen? So this is how you should be able to print first month, last month, if you wanted to print. So let me write this. Tomorrow, if you wanted to print something and see what is the data it is printing, you should be able to always use these statements. Okay. So like that, you should be able to get it. Now let me execute, alter this stored prop. So all these things you need to practice, how to get the last month, this month, that month. Okay, let me execute it. Now you see February 1st to February 28th. Okay, we can have only three letters. Okay, but I have taken a lot of this one, so you can, you know, take only three letters because it is this one, and I need to have a space. So the report, I want to have only three letters. So what we can do, so this is the complete name you're getting, right? So last month, I would like to get the three letters from the last month, right? So what I do, so I would like to apply substring function here to get, you know, only three letters. Get the three letters. To do that, I'll do select last month, use substring function. Okay, substring function, and read first two three letters, and you will be able to store that data you declare month name short. One more, you know, we'll declare one more variable. Let us say maximum only three letters I would like to have it. Now this is the one I'm going to be declaring short month. So I'm going to be getting only three. Okay, three letters. So take the month name, get first two three letters, and that will be stored in this. Now I wanted to print this. Okay, you will be able to get it. I'm commenting. So this one I wanted to use, not last month name, last month. Then I need to have a space. Okay, that's it. So execute. Now you go there and see, you are able to get February 1st to February 28th, 2021. So this is not hard coded. Clear? So probably you can change. You assume that your date is, okay, your date is not the get date. You're in June month, okay? So June month means 2021. So June and 20, June, let us say 10th. So now see what happens. It is going to be printing the data from the previous month. Now you see, when you execute it, It is going to be printing May 1st to May 31st. Have you seen this? So it is not hard coded. So automatically it is going to be bringing previous month data, list of transactions from May 1st to May 31st. You know, 2021. So last day and first day, everything I have implemented. Clear? So like that, you need to implement all this logic only. This is what is the fun when you practice. When you write more code, you will be able to have, because we have implemented date and time functions. We had implemented a lot of other things. So this is how you are going to understand, and this is how you can implement a lot of things. Clear? So we should not hard code any date here. So this will be always what? Get a date. Okay. So whenever you run this stored procedure, this stored procedure is supposed to give me a last month date. Clear? So how can we implement this? So there are many logics that we can implement. So this is the one logic I have taken. Okay. So get the last month and declare one variable, then get the last month name here. So using that, get the three letters from the last month. For this purpose, I have taken one more variable and last month in short. Okay. So last month, first three letters I'm capturing. So all these things, programming, we already understood substrings in our queries, right? So if you see carefully, whatever you have learned so far, everything is implemented in your stored procedure. Clear? So this is how you have to write a stored procedure. And writing stored procedure is not, you know, after day job, one day job. People will give you a lot of time. They may give you 10 days, 20 days, 1 month also, because you need to understand the domain and write a lot of logic, right? So it cannot be done in one day's time. Since it is a training, I have done this many times. I'm able to write in 1 hour time or 30 minutes time. In the real time, even I will take a lot of time to implement it, right? So people will give you a lot of time to understand the, you know, requirements and implement one by one. See, only to implement this line, this much of a code we have written. See how many lines of code we have written. Dynamically, you're printing the date. Right? So all these things are very, very important to understand. So in the real time, you may be writing 1,000 lines of that code, but patiently you need to understand what they're doing. If I give this code to somebody else, they don't understand anything. What these guys are doing, what is this? They don't understand because they never implemented any, you know, stored procedures. Okay. You keep on writing everything into stored procedure. This is one stored procedure. Okay. So you can tell them that we implement a lot of banking transactions, and these transactions purpose we write complex stored procedures, and that's what we implemented. Or whenever you take loans and everything, customer goes to the bank and they wanted to have a loan statement. Okay, so that is also implemented in the stored procedures only. So like that, you can take in anything, you can check anything, right? So that's what you need to implement. So once it is executed, it is centralized. So you can just close this. Then I need not save it anywhere. You should be able to do this, and you can do it for any other customer, 105, any other customer. So this customer, no transactions at all. So clearly it is showing no transactions at all in the last month. Okay, last month means this. You can give any other customers data, so that it is going to be printing. These customers also does not have anything. Clear, guys? So you can implement this and try to, you know, at least understand. Now we have one more case study called school case study. In this also we have course master table and student master table, enrollment master. You people would have created all these, you know, queries. I think if you go to the end, so in the page number four, after page number four, there is a five. Using the above tables layout schema, write a stored procedure for the below specifications. Okay, this is the requirement. It is stated in this. Now they're clearly telling, input parameters date from and date to. Okay, date from is mandatory, date to is optional. If not specified, take the current date. Okay, clear? So as a default value, and student ID is mandatory. These are the input parameters. Clear? Then they're clearly giving you requirement. What is it? Course wise, enrollment wise, in ascending order of the course name to be printed. If no enrollment exists for a given course for the period specified, print the course name and the or remarks column no enrollment for the period. Clear? So this is how it has to print enrollment details of student name from date to date. You need to print it, then origin, then serial number, course name, date of enrollment, fee waiver, grade, yes or no. Now, so how many enrollments has been done by the store? Okay, total number of courses enrolled. For example, you people are going to be enrolling the course with goonlinetrainings.com. For example, let us take Simrit. So she enrolled for SQL Server, she enrolled for MSBA, she enrolled for a lot of courses, right? Now her course number, her student number would be, let us say, 101. If I provide her student ID is 101, and if I give date, let us say January to the today's date, from January to today's date, how many courses she has enrolled in our institute? That is the report I would like to have it. So I give the date from and date to. Date to is today's date. You need to take it. And student ID, I will give 101 or 102 student name. So what I supposed to get it? The serial number one, she is enrolled for SQL Server. Date of enrollment, fee waiver is no. And grade, some grade. Next course she is enrolled, say Java or MSBA. And next course she is enrolled, let us say MSBA project. So these three things need to be printed. Clear? Total number of courses enrolled by Simlet is 3. You need to print it 3 here. And if there is no enrollment done for given period, for example, I give the same student, but I'll give last year. Last year, this student did not come. So you need to mention in the remarks, okay, saying that no enrollment has been done by the student. So that is the message you need to give it. Clear? So this is the header line. So header line means enrollment details for the student name. Student name, because when I give 101, you need to pick up the student name that has to be printed. Plus these two dates you need to print it, from date and a to date. So this is the header line. So header line means however we are printing this header line, right? This is the header line. Okay, so that needs to be printed in your school stored procedure. Clear? So you have the student IDs, right? If you input one student ID and from date and to date, how many courses she is enrolled, what is the origin of the student, what is the type of the student, so everything is available, and these two are the headers, and you need to print all of them. That's it. Clear? This is also one more small stored procedure that you can achieve with the help of the above tables. Okay, all the data is available. Only thing is that you need to use these tables. What is the type? What is the grade? Grade is available here. Student type and origin is available here. So that you need to print it. And using course table and school, this table and enrollment table, you should be able to get the data. Clear? You try this stored procedure and send it to me for review. If you don't understand anything, you can ask me anytime. Clear? So this is where you need to print. You can use a printing command here and print this line. And after this print, and we can have these two lines. Then after that, number of enrollments. This data, you will be able to get it from where? Enrollment master table. Clear? And you need to loop through it. Loop through it with the help of a while loop and print course number one, course number two, course number three, and at the end, number of enrollments is 3, and that's it. It is very, very simple stored proc, but you should be able to achieve it. Clear, guys? And these are the things. Now, let me give you one more requirement. Okay, so that is, let me close this. I would like to give you one more requirement. Whenever you go to bank, okay, so whenever you go to a bank, for the loan especially, okay, loans normally we create. I wanted to create a stored proc for the loan statement. Okay, so let me give you a requirement for this stored procedure requirement. So whenever you go to the bank, you will ask them what is the loan amount. This will be a input parameter for the stored proc. Okay, so I am writing input parameter, right? Loan amount, the customer will inform or customer will ask, I need, you know, 3000, let us say hundreds or 3000 or 3 lakhs or 3000 hundreds, whatever the loan amount that you need to specify here. And when you specify, they will tell you, sir, this is the rate of interest, because rate of interest also need to be inputted. And what is the tenure? Tenure means duration. Okay, tenure in years. Clear? For example, I need this much of amount. Okay, so this is the amount, 200,000, right? So this is the amount I wanted to have it, 2 lakhs. And rate of interest would be, let us say, 12% per annum. And tenure, I wanted to take this amount for 3 years. Now you have to create a statement. So what is that? The statement has to come like this: month number and date, date of EMI and EMI amount. Okay, equal monthly installment amount. Okay, so this is what I need to print in my statement. Clear? So to do that, what are the things that you need to implement? Because these are the input data. So using this data, I need to find out what is the interest, right? So step number one, you have to find out the interest. Okay, get the interest. So to get the interest, the business may be using a formula. Ask them the formula, because you're not a, you know, banker, or you're not a, you know, you cannot use our own formulas and everything. You ask the business what is the formula that they're using. So let us say they're using a formula as a PNR by 100. So this may be right or wrong, I don't know, but I'm giving you some formula. Okay, so PNR by 100, principal amount and rate of interest and tenure. Clear? PNR by 100. So you should be able to declare at the rate interest amount will be a variable. Okay, so this will be money. So what I do, I said I wanted to find out interest amount, this one. Okay, so interest amount, principal amount is this amount, control C into, okay, and ROI into tenure in years, okay, into 100. Let me put and divided by 100. Clear? So this will give me the interest amount. Clear? So this will give me interest amount plus. So the next step would be total amount. You need to get it. So how do you get total amount? We have to say declare at the rate total amount will be money. It will be total amount is equivalent to the loan amount. This is a 2 lakhs or 200,000 plus the interest amount. Interest amount is something you will get it, right? So it may be X amount, X plus Y, that will be the total amount. But I don't need total amount. The step number three, I wanted to find out EMI amount. Okay, so get EMI amount. So how to get EMI amount? Declare at the rate EMI amount, okay, which is also a money. And EMI can be calculated total amount, that is something divided by, you know, divided by, you will be able to have tenure in years into 12. Because 3 years into 12 means 36 months. Okay. So total amount divided by this. So this is the formula. You can use it. You should be able to get each month EMI amount. Okay. So that's it. This EMI amount, this you need to print it here. When you get the EMI amount, so that you need to print it here. For the first month, EMI data, first month, for example, today you have taken the loan. The first EMI will start next month. So April 3rd, 2021, EMI amount will be this amount. You need to print it here. Okay. The next month, second month again, second month, okay, it will be May 3rd, 2021. Like that, the EMI amount need to be printed. Clear? So this is a statement I wanted to have it. So only the input parameters are this. Clear? Let me create one simple loan statement. So always you need to say use IBank. And go and okay, so this is what I have copied from that, because I don't want to, you know, write everything. I don't want to waste my time. So loan statement, Bhaskar Jogi, March 3rd IBank, it will prepare the loan statement, history, new SP. So this is the loan statement and create a proc. So we knew that we have to provide as begin and always you write these lines first. So what are the things that you need to give? First is loan amount, which is money input parameter, and then rate of interest could be integer or decimal, whatever you wanted to have, and tenure in years. Okay, this will be a tiny int means it can take 0 to 255, and even this can be a tiny int, because integer cannot be a big number. So this could be 0 to 255 numbers, and that's it. So these are the three input parameters. So I wanted to create this. So these are the steps I have to implement, right? So simply copy this and control C and control V. So that is the code. Step number one. So this is step number one, get the interest, okay? And step number two, comment this, total amount. Get the total amount. Step number three, and get the EMI amount, okay? So declared. So this is the formula the business is given me. So this is not my own formula. So interest amount will be this. Okay, if you wanted to see the interest amount, that is also you can print and see what is the interest amount. Okay, so you can always have a print function and see the interest amount. You can have it there. Okay, and if you wanted to see the total amount, you can have a at the end. You can use a print command and see the, what is the amount here. If you wanted to have this amount, then you can also have print an EMI amount. Okay, if you put some this value, so here you need to print, right? So you can say print, open the bracket, because this is loan statement, close it. Now month number, so print, open the bracket, and you should be able to not the bracket, the single quotes, then put the single quote here, then you can have a single quote here. That's it. Okay, so this is what is ready. Now I am not printing anything, simply I would like to create this stored proc first. Okay, so these are the steps already we have done it. So this is going to be giving me EMI amount, total amount, and interest amount. Okay, nothing else it can give me. So this is what is my proc. Let me execute it. Now, how can we call a proc using this? So go to here, and I should be able to call the proc. Right, exec, stored proc name, loan amount, I need this much, rate of interest is this much, and I would like to go in for 3 years. Now execute. Now you see, so this is the interest and total amount, 2 lakhs plus this one, and every month you need to pay this much amount. Okay, that's it. So month number you need to print it, and date of EMI you need to print it, and EMI amount, that's it, nothing else. So you need already all the data, then you can use a loop and print it. Clear? Now if tomorrow if I wanted to make it for 5 lakhs and rate of interest is, let us say, 14% per annum, and I would like to go in for 3 years. Now you can execute. Now this is the calculation. Total interest is 21,000. So this is the 71,000, right, or something like this. And this is the every month amount that you need to pay it, 19,722.22. Clear? So the calculations are done, and you should be able to print them. So for the printing purpose, month by month I need to print it. So for that purpose, I'm going to be using a loop. Clear? So loop, I have to use it. For the looping purpose, I need one variable. Declare x is integer, which is a initialization. At the rate x value is equals to 1. Then I say while loop. So at the rate x value is how many, months it has to print. It has to print this into this, because if it is a 3 years, 3 years into 12, 36 months it has to print. Now this is the thing I need to have it. Okay, so how many times, what is the condition? It is this into this, these many times it has to run. So 3 years means 3 into 12 36, x value till become 36 it has to work. Okay, begin and end. Okay, so this is what I should have it. So what is that I should be able to print? Month number. Month number means I can print at the rate x value. So let me say cast it, and as varchar. Okay, varchar, it has to print 1 2 3 4 5, because x value is equals to 1. So x value itself is a month number, plus I wanted to convert. I would like to print a date. For that purpose, what I'm trying to give, I'll create a loan date. Okay, loan date will be, declare one more variable, declare loan date, you take as a today's date only. Okay, date and time. So loan date is equivalent to, let me consider this as a today's date only, get a date. Okay, so it will be loan date. So that I'm going to be putting it here. So varchar, comma, loan date. Okay, it is going to be printing today's date, but I'll be needing Indian tile style, right? 107. If you need American style, you can put 101. Clear? I need Indian style. I would like to have like this. It is going to be converting into this plus and EMI amount. EMI amount is available in this. Now you can have cast EMI amount as varchar. That's it. It is going to be printing. So after that, what you do after printing, you need to increment, set at the rate x is equivalent to at the rate x plus 1. Okay, so this is what is called a printing. You need to print the, this is what is called action. Okay, so initialization, condition, action, increment. If the, so that's it. So this is how you should be able to print. Once everything is over, then you have to come out, okay, and print this one. This is the end of the loop. Okay, so which end is what you need to know, and in between we need to get some space, right? So space of, let us say, 5. Let me implement this space. And I would like to get space, right? So let me alter this stored proc. So what are the things I have written? You observe carefully. Okay. So use IBank, go, and this story. And three things I have taken as input parameter. Tomorrow's class will discuss about output parameters, right? So the formula is PNR by 100. I'm planning to calculate this interest amount, and this is the formula into by divided by 100. Now this I don't want to print because it is everything is, you know, fine. Now I don't want to print this. I would like to print in our table only. So loan date also I've declared one more variable. I'm planning to use this. Clear? So in the loop I wanted to run the loop for each month. Clear? Because EMI means monthly need to be paid, right? So I need to print this for each and every month. So X value is equivalent to 1. So tenure 3 or 4, 4 into 12, 48 months, 48 times it is going to be printed. That's it, nothing else. Now I wanted to simply execute, but I put alter, execute this. Now I go and see now. Have you seen this? Month number 1, March 3rd, he has to pay this much of amount. Again, March 3rd, it is not changing. Okay, it has to change. 36, fine, but it is not going to the next month. Everything is good, so that is not good. So what I'm trying to do, I trying to increase the month. Okay, so to increase the month, what we need to do, we need to say date add. Okay, comma 1 month you need to increase always, and you need to close it. Okay, every month you need to, so first month, you know, you need to increment by 1, increment by 2. So one value I should not, you know, give a hard-coded value. Instead of this, I'll give x value. X value will be 1, x value will be 2. So one month extra means it is April, May, June, July. So this is the one you need to modify and write. Okay, that's it. So click on execute. Now you see the data. Now you see, oh, there is a problem here. It is not. So there is an issue in our code. So okay, so you need to put the bracket here and execute it. Now let me execute this. Now you see April 3rd is the first EMI, and this is April, then May, June, then 21, after 21 Jan 22, and your loan will get end over by March 3rd 2024. And at the end, if you wanted to print a total amount, so already total amount we have it, where total amount is available in this total amount, this you can print it. Okay, you can just go back and print, say total amount in INR. Okay, you can print like this, and cast as varchar. Okay, now you take this and you should be able to give like this and click on execute. You should be able to print the total amount at the end. Have you seen this? So this is the total amount that they paid. Okay, they have taken this amount. If you wanted to print what is the amount they have taken, so that is also can be printed, and otherwise you just leave it. Okay, so this is the EMI loan statement table. Clear? So you can also specify whatever you wanted to write, loan statement table. If you want to have something like this, we can say print loan statement table, something like this you can print. Okay, so you should be able to get something like this loan statement table, and you should be able to get this. Clear? What is the total amount they're paying? This is the amount. If they're paying, let us say 11% for this amount and for, let us say, 1 year. Now see the calculations. Okay, so this much amount they need to pay, and this is the total amount in INR, Indian rupees. This is the amount that they have to pay. Clear? So like that. So only 12 months it is printing. Have you seen this? The loop will be continued only for 12 months. Clear? So all these things you can experiment it. Very, very simple thing. So whatever you wanted to do it, you should be able to do it. Clear? So that's what. Now I am closing everything. You need not worry about it, right? So all the stored procedures are available here. So anytime you can just go back and you can see the to each and every stored proc here clearly. So get account balance, loan statement, you know, previous month bank statement, whatever you wanted to have it, you should be able to have it in the real time. You will see thousands of stored procedures in a given, you know, bank database or any insurance company. You will have lots of tables, lot of stored procedures which are complex in nature, right? You need to understand one by one slowly. It is very, very easy for you to capture it, for you to understand it, but you need to practice more. Without practice, you will not be able to achieve anything, guys. So this is what is for today, and if you have any questions, you're welcome, guys. Okay, so tomorrow we'll see how to use output parameters, how to use return statement, how to use, you know, exception handling or try catch blocks or error handlings. If you get any error at the time of executing a stored proc, how do you handle it? So that is what is called error handling, right? We were discussing the error handling in SSIS also. If you get any error, what we were doing? We were logging everything into a logging table in SSIS. Same thing can be implemented in SQL Server. If you're executing a stored proc, if you get any error in middle of the execution, what will you do? You need to log those details into a separate table. So how do you do that? So that we're going to discuss. So we have how to use output parameter, return statements, and error handling. If you know these three things, that's it. You can now write, you know, SQL and TSQL as part of your stored procedures. You should be able to write simple to complex stored procedures very, very easily. Thank you, guys. Since you do not know the programming, you might be hesitate to write this, because I told you, if you watch at least 20 hours of C programming language videos in YouTube, people who say I'm very, very weak in programming. Okay, so what my suggestion is, just watch daily 1 hour or 30 minutes of C videos tutorials from very, very basic level to 20-30 classes. When you watch it, so you can write wonderful stored procedures, because stored procedures completely programming, declaring a variables, writing the loops, printing it, nothing else, right? That's it, only these things. So if you wanted to learn this programming, I'll, you know, my request is to watch at least C language tutorials. If you're first time coming to the IT industry, you spend some more time, right? You take 1 more month extra, you complete at least that one, that will give you much more confidence to create complex stored procedures.